Thank you for how you come to us, how you actually never left, and that you are ready always for us when we turn back to you. Your pursuit of us is amazing. May you be blessed, Father, as we sing these words, as we pray, as we reflect, as we listen to the word, all of these acts of worship, all of these acts of worship, may you be glorified. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. Amen. Hey, thank you for that truth. Hey, you guys can grab a seat. I'd like to welcome you to 1Mosaic, and a couple quick things. If you would, if you have your Bibles, I'd like to invite you to turn to the Gospel of Matthew, very first book in the New Testament. So if you can open up there, Matthew chapter 25 is where we're going to be spending some time this morning. We're going to be taking off from there. So if you are a phone Bible person or an app Bible person, that's fine too, okay? You can get on your phone or your tablet and get that opened up. But something rich about holding the actual pages of the Word of God. So Matthew 25, and as you guys flip there, let me just remind you of a couple quick things. One, we'd really like to invite you all to stay around for an extra 5 or 10 minutes if you would. And our M groups are stationed outside around the cafe out here. And we would just encourage you to go meet some of our M group leaders. You can see a little bit about when they meet, what they do for childcare, what their group's about. Grab some snacks, which is always a great thing. Just hang out for a little while. We're going to do what we can to get you guys out of here as close to on time as possible today, so that you have a little time to mingle out there. So make sure you take advantage of that. Meet some of the M group leaders. We really want to encourage you guys to get plugged in, if at all possible, into these smaller group communities, to just continue to dive into the Word. They're called M groups because we call them missional groups. Missional towards being in God's Word, missional towards community, missional towards serving people. And that's the hope of these groups, is that they empower you to do all three of those with some folks from this community. The other thing I want to remind you is 2 weeks ago, I did a teaching on our mission and vision. We called it On Mission Sunday, so that was the 12th of March. And if you guys happen to miss that, it's online. You can go on our website. You can click on it. You can watch the live teaching. I would encourage you to watch the live teaching. We did a lot of whiteboarding and visual stuff. But we also want to encourage you to bring back and sign your On Mission covenants. If you feel led to journey with us over the next year and where God's calling us as a faith community, we would like to ask you to step that commitment up and sign those On Mission covenants. And what that is you're committing to us, we're committing to you, we're in this together. You'll have an architect that will be assigned to your name, praying for you guys, someone you can reach out to if you need anything. And just another level of accountability, of us saying, hey, we're doing this together. This is what God called us into. Let's really rally around this thing, okay? One of the biggest things about our On Mission covenant is not lying or forging things like the NCAA tournament bracket. So I checked yesterday afternoon, and Dan Crist was in second place out of 38 teams behind the one and only Chris Van Etten, who seems to win every year, okay? I went on this morning, and I'm in like 38th place because somehow my final selection of North Carolina in the finals turned to Notre Dame. So as much as I'm a Notre Dame fan, Scott Van Etten and Brian Winder are the only two that have administrative rights over that. So one's going to get fired and one's going to be kicked off the architect team. So, and Chris, you and I are going to go have lunch when you and I win that tournament. So I'll let you know. We'll keep you updated on where that's at. But I just want to let you know where the standings were as of this morning. Okay, so anyways, here we go, Matthew 25. If you're in your text, turn with me to Matthew 25, starting in verse 14. And let me read and explain to you a little bit of what's going on here. I'm going to read a good chunk. I'm going to read through verse 30. So this scripture is not going to be on the screen, so please just follow along. It says this: again, it will be like a man going. It will be like, what is it will be like that Jesus is referring to here? He is referring to the kingdom of God. Okay, so when he is saying it will be like, it will be like the kingdom of God will be like, and he's about ready to tell us something really important here because he's talking about the kingdom. And let me remind you, the kingdom is both now and coming. Okay, the kingdom of God is both here and future. It's present and future. So we are living in the kingdom of God, and there's more to be revealed about the kingdom of God as we continue into the future. So it will be like a man going on a journey. Listen to some of this language about the man, the imagery. Try to think who Jesus is maybe alluding to, this man going on a journey, who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. Okay, so we have a man who's going on a journey. He calls his servants and he entrusts his wealth to them. May I suggest to you that Jesus is alluding to himself? Okay, this parable, he's setting up this parable of the kingdom of heaven, and he's referring to the man, Jesus, going on a journey, calling his servants. The Greek translation there is doulos, a word we love around here, which means bond servant, okay, which means a servant who was set free and willfully chose to come back to the master. A beautiful imagery where the master says, you have been set free. You're free to leave. You're free to do what you want to do. And they choose to come back and stay under the authority of the master. So a doulos is entrusted with his wealth. Now, when we hear the word wealth, our minds immediately go to the Benjamins, right? Show me the money. Let me tell you that this word wealth means so much more in this text. The wealth here actually means possessions. It's like everything. It's like your estate. It's like your will. It's like he's saying he has entrusted everything to them. So as we're reading this, I want you to understand we are talking about money, yes, financially, but we're also talking about a whole lot of other things that have been entrusted to these servants, okay? So here's how it continues. In verse 15, it says, to one, he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another 1 bag, each according to his ability, and then he went on the journey. All right, so what are these bags of gold? What do these represent? So the word here is a talent. So a bag of gold in first century was considered a talent. It was based on weight. And a talent was equivalent to 20 years' wages of a day laborer. Okay, so 20 years. So the guy that got 1 talent, 1 bag of gold, got the equivalent of a day worker's wages for 20 years. So let me try to translate that for a quick minute into Lenawee County, 2017, all right? Let's just say, for example, a good, hardworking man or woman, a day's wages that works, you know, 40, 50 hours a week, brings in $50,000 a year. 20 years worth, we're talking about a gift of $1 million. Someone coming up to you and giving you a bag of $1 million. Okay, because some of us, when we read this, they go, well, that's kind of rude. He gave 1 5, 1 2, and 1 1. Come on, man. You know, but listen, we're not talking about dollar bills. We're talking about $1 million. So let me ask you a question. Well, we're all really selfish, so maybe don't answer this. But if I were to come give you, if I gave Jeff $1 million, and then I gave Tim $2 million, and I give Jake $5 million, is Jeff really going to be like that distraught that he didn't get the $5 million or the $10 million? Don't answer that. We may be that distraught, okay? No, it's $1 million. The point, when Jesus tells these parables, he's always pushing the envelope. He's always pushing it to the extreme to make the point. This is 20 years of your wages. Okay, so this is what Jesus gives us, this idea of he's giving everything, okay? And don't forget wealth, meaning, possessions, everything, all, giving it all. So here's what happens after he goes on his journey. The man who received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. Master, Jesus, money, wealth, possessions. How often do we look like this guy? And Jesus gives us these unbelievable gifts throughout our lives. And we go and we dig a hole and we bury him. And we do everything we can to just keep them safe. To not lose them, but yet we also don't use them. Okay? So, here's what happens. After a long time, the master of those servants returns to settle accounts. Sound like anything biblical, maybe? Kind of hearing a little bit. Okay? He returns to settle the accounts with them. The man who received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. Something that we all want to hear. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share in your master's happiness. How cool to make our master Jesus happy. The man with 2 bags of gold also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 bags of gold. See, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the man who had received 1 bag of gold came. Master, he said, I knew that you were a hard man, harvesting where you had not sown and gathering where you had not scattered seed. So I was afraid, fear. I was afraid, and I went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. Now, listen to what happens here. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. Now, here's the thing. If this servant really thought the master was going to be that harsh, like there's a problem even in his argument. If he thought the master was going to be that harsh, why would he have not worked all the harder to invest the money, to do something to get a return? But instead, he goes and he hides it, and he's making an excuse, and right away, the parable, Jesus says, you wicked, lazy servant. You knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. Like the least you could have done is invested it wisely. You could have at least put it in with the bank and you could have got interest back. And then in verse 28, and here's where we see the spiritual gravity of this chunk of scripture. Take the bag of gold from him and give it to the one who has 10 bags. For those who have will be given more, and they will have an abundance. And for those who do not have, what they had will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Yikes. Welcome to 1 Mosaic. Here's the thing I want you to catch about this scripture. For some of us, we think about those who have will be given more, and those who have not will lose, will be taken away. And we think about that pre-encounter with Jesus. And we think, well, this parable sounds really, really rough. this parable sounds like, you know, the rich are just going to get richer and the poor are just going to get poorer, and that's the way Jesus wants it. This part of the parable, it's in order. Everything Jesus did was intentional and in order and made sense. It comes after the gift was presented. What is the gift? The gift is Christ. And so the one who had 10 bags or 5 bags, the one who had 2 bags, the one who had 1 bag, they were all presented a gift. Okay? Same, an unbelievable gift. Remember the $1 million, a huge gift, a life-altering gift. And so this is saying after you receive that gift, what you do with it, how you respond to the gift decides whether you will get more or whether you will get less. So the imagery in this parable that Jesus is talking about here is after we die and how we responded to the gift. And for those of us who have responded and invested well in the gift in Christ, we will get exceedingly more, meaning heaven, eternity with him, salvation. For those of us who don't accept the gift and don't handle it the right way, we will lose everything, eternal separation from him. And this is serious. And Jesus goes on and talks about this imagery of weeping and gnashing of teeth, which we hear about in Scripture time and time again when we talk about hell. So guys, this is for real, okay? This scripture is for real. I'm glad you guys are here because this really matters. Your life is a gift, okay? Throw that next slide up. Just want to talk about this gift idea. Your life is a gift, yet so many of us do not see our life this way. We don't see it this way. Here's the thing, you didn't create it, and you don't control it. So therefore, it is a gift. All right, think about, go back to the womb for a minute. Y'all remember the womb, right? Remember being in there? All nice and warm and cuddly, you know, sucking on your thumb, getting fed through this weird tube in your belly, right? Were you in there and were you thinking like, man, I really hope that I have a receding hairline by the time I'm 38. God, if, you know, I'm going to kind of like change and rewire a few DNA strands. Or, you know what, I wish I could be 6'8", right? If I could be 6 foot or so, I'm going to rewire that and I'm going to make that happen, right? Because we were all in control in the womb, weren't we? Right? No? Okay, so you don't remember the womb. Sorry about that. How about your breath? Right? Y'all control, you regulate your breath, right? Well, you think so for a minute. You're like, look at that. Look at that. I'm controlling my breath. Okay, give me 5 minutes, okay? Let me see you regulate your breath for 5 minutes. Let me see you regulate your breath for 3 minutes. What will happen is you'll all start dropping like flies, and you'll start breathing just like normal because you don't control it. You didn't create it. You don't regulate it. You can't mandate it. Okay, let's talk about your heart for a minute, your heartbeat. Let's see you guys make your heartbeat. Just skip a beat or two. Can you do that? Okay, no pacemakers, all right? No pacemakers unless someone's like, watch this. Okay, without the remote control thing, just let me see you. Let me see you just skip a beat. Like, focus for a minute. Friends, we can do this. Think about your heart. Skip a beat. Come on, heart, skip a beat. Man, we are not in control. We're so not in control of our lives. Our lives are the biggest gift we've ever been given. But yet so many of us live our lives as if we created them. We designed them. We control them. And it's not the case. Life is an absolute gift, and it's a gift from God. Here's what some of the scriptures say about this. Genesis 1:27. I love the last song that we sang and what John was sharing, and it's great when we sing about the exact same thing we're teaching, and God just does that. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female. He created them. You had nothing to do with it, friends. You never have, you never will. You didn't create anything. Then, in Genesis 2:7, Then the Lord God formed a man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And the man became a living being. God took him out of dust and he created him. And he breathed the breath of life into him. And in that moment, our heartbeats began and our breathing began and the gift of life began. And you and I had nothing to do with that. We don't control it. Look at Psalm 139, a great psalm that you guys have probably all heard, one of my favorite psalms. Psalm 139, 13 and 14 says, "For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb." Have you guys ever seen like a really amazing knitter? Okay, it's not like anything you see on TV a lot, like ESPN, knit, you know, the Ocho knitting challenge, right? But if you guys have ever seen this, I remember watching some lady on the plane next to me one time. I think we were actually going to Haiti, and she was knitting. She was knitting like this furious, like, and I'm like, holy cow, you just created an entire Afghan in like 30 minutes, you know? It was incredible. And to get this imagery of this is what God did while we were in our mother's womb. Man, he wired us together. He made us exactly how he wanted us. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. Church, do you know that full well? Some of you, we could just stop this teaching right here. That's all you needed to hear this morning. You were fearfully and wonderfully made by Creator God. He knit you together. He made you perfect. And you should praise him for that. You should understand that. We need to know that full well. Our lives are not a mistake. Our receding hairlines are not a mistake. Okay? Our shortness is not a mistake. This is how God made us. He made every one of us exactly how he wanted to make us. There's another thing that's a gift that I think we take for granted quite often. And it's time. Okay? Your time is a gift. Your time's a gift. But how often do we look at time as a gift? I don't think we do. Again, I think we often think we started it. I think we can stop it. I think we can control it at times. We can slow it down. We can speed it up. We often live like it really doesn't matter a whole lot. And so there's a piece of scripture I want to read to you that where the Bible talks about this, and it's in James, which is an incredible book. And if you want to flip there real quick, if not, it'll be on the screen. James chapter 4, verses 13 through 17. And listen to what this says. "Now listen, you who say today or tomorrow, we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business and make money. Why do you not even know what will happen tomorrow? What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes. All such boasting is evil." Now listen to this last line. Great piece of scripture. You want a scripture memory. James 4:17. "So then, if you know the good you ought to do and don't do it, you sin." If you know the good you ought to do and you don't do it, you sin. Friends, this is the sin of omission. It's not the sin of commission. It's not the sin of, oh crap, I did that again. I looked at that person wrong. I said that. That flew out of my mouth. This is the sin of omission that a lot of us forget about. This is knowing what's right, knowing what we're supposed to do, knowing that the Holy Spirit prompts something inside of us and we go, no thanks. I'm not going to do that. And I would argue the sin of omission is the biggest thing that we look at when we look at our time. I don't think we sin so much in how we spend our time. I think we sin in how we don't spend our time. And all of a sudden, we get to a point in our life where our world starts crashing down, and we look back at this thing called life, this timeline, and we go, oh my, I wish this, I wish that, I wish this, I wish I would have done. It's omission. Okay, so James is talking hard about this. Friends, we have to understand that our time is a gift from God. We do not control it. We can't hit the pause button. We can't fast forward. We can't rewind. Time is linear. It's moving. We can't stop it. And how we spend our time matters. Okay? So, another one. Your talent is a gift. Okay? Your talent is a gift. Now, some of you may argue, well, I can get better at things. I can learn things with practice and yada, yada, yada. If I want to learn how to write left-handed, I can learn how to write left-handed. And if I practice long enough, I can get it. Yeah, you can. You know why? Because God's given you a talent to learn how to write left-handed. God's done that for you, right? God has given you those talents. But at the same time, there's some of us, like, we have to understand God gives those, and for some he gives, and for some he doesn't. And there's times that we don't get certain talents, and that's okay. And that's the point of what Jesus was laying out in Matthew 25. That's why he gave some five, some two, and one. He gave them according to their ability. Okay? So, there's a few things in my life that I'm not great at. One of them, Ryan Bills will attest to. And it's called tetherball. Okay? If any of you guys have seen the Will Ferrell movie, Kicking and Screaming, where his dad is like pounding on Will Ferrell with the tetherball thing, you know, he's just like going at him, just beating him down with this thing. Last summer, well, we go to this camp and we go with Ryan and Jolene a lot, and Ryan always thinks it's fun to play tetherball, okay? And why, I don't know. I mean, I look like a paraplegic out there trying to play tetherball. I mean, it's just terrible, right? So he gets out there and he thinks it's really funny. Hey, Dan, let's go play tetherball. And come on, dude. Let's go, like, shoot hoops. Let's play tetherball. And so the tetherball court is, like, right in the middle of the camp, which is a great place for it to be, right? So we start playing and he hits it, you know, and I'm like, wow, I totally missed that, right? And it's over my head, and I jump in and just looking like an idiot, and the ball is spinning around, you know, and he's laughing so hard, and it's so loud, and I'm laughing so hard, and then all of a sudden you, like, pause, and there's, like, 75 women and children standing around watching. I'm like, this is really, really great. Thank you. This is good for my manhood. I feel really great. So God did not gift me in tetherball, okay? I cannot do tetherball. Tetherball's rough for me. Ryan, he's a great tetherball player. Now, there's some things that I have on Ryan. I'm not going to talk about them today because that would be bragging, and Scripture says something about that, so I'm going to be humble. We'll talk about that later. I'll send it in the email. But no, here's the thing. Tetherball, like, it's serious. I don't have any tetherball skills, believe me. But here's the thing. This is talking about a lot bigger things than tetherball. This is talking about your God-given abilities to relate to people, to minister to people, to advance God's kingdom. What Matthew 25 is talking about, the kingdom of heaven, it's here and now and it's coming. Okay, so look at what God says about who we are and how he created us. Look at Ephesians 2:10, incredible scripture, and I know a lot of you guys probably know this, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. I love that word handiwork. You are literally the handiwork of Almighty God. He designed you exactly how he wanted to design you. And he prepared in advance what you would do with those good works, with those skills, with the way he equipped you. Look at 1 Peter 4:10. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. friends, like, we have to understand we're called to use our gifts. We have to understand that this text reminds us that it comes in various forms, that it is a form of grace that God lavishes on us. And some will get what seems like a lot. Some will get what seems like a few. It's all important. Okay? And we're called to use it to serve others and to be faithful stewards of these gifts that God's given to us. Okay? So our talents are a gift. What you can do, whatever that may be, whether you're an engineer and your brain just thinks like no one else, or whether you're a relational person and you can connect and talk really easily and you make conversations fun and easier, or whether you're this incredible baker and you serve by baking and just loving and serving people with food, or you know, whether it's you manage money well and you start pulling people together and you say, listen, we gotta get serious about how we live and how we spend our money and what we do with it. You know, there's all these things that God has positioned you and gifted you all with. And we're called to use those to serve one another. Here's the last one that I want to talk about for a few minutes here. And you're like, oh crap, here it comes. But this matters. Your treasure is a gift. Okay, your treasures are gifts. They're gifts from God. And when we think about this monetarily, some of us are so quick to go, no, they're not, man. God's not working 40, 50, 60, 70 hours a week. I'm doing that. Well, let me rewind what we just talked about for the last 15 minutes, okay? Without your time, which was a gift, without your talent, which is a gift, without your very life, which is a gift, there's no way you could ever acquire any of the treasures that you think are yours. So when we look at it through the lens of what we just journeyed through, that our life's a gift, our time's a gift, our talent's a gift, and if we acknowledge that, which I think we all do, and we go, yep, that's true, then the only way we can accumulate treasures, and I'm talking earthly treasures here, the only way we can accumulate anything, that we can make money or we can have a house or we can have a vehicle, is because God's given us the very breath to do that. God keeps our heart beating while we're at work. God's given us gifts and talents that align with what we're doing at work. God's given us time to do that, to make money. So our treasures are absolutely gifts from God. And the nice thing for me is talking about money doesn't have to happen a lot here. And I don't know if that's good or bad, to be really honest with you. In 6 years of this faith community existing, I could probably count probably that many times that I've talked about money. I may have had JP do one once because we give him all the hard topics, right? But seriously, man, I'm talking like one time a year or less. Do we have to talk about money? And I bless God for that, and all the glory goes to him, because we've always been able to sustain everything here and give to that 50-50 mission. And there are a lot of pastors in this area and beyond that it's like a quarterly thing that they have to do, and they dread it. Again, oh my gosh, we got to talk about money again. We don't need to do that. Why I say I don't know if it's good or bad, because the number one thing that I would say hinders our culture from really fully experiencing Jesus is our treasures. And so it's not fun to stand up here and talk about that, but I would argue it's probably the leading thing in our culture that gets in the way, that creates a divide between us and who Jesus really wants us to be. Is our pocketbook, our bank statement, or whatever you want to call it. Okay? And as culture goes, this is not just a culture problem, it's a church problem, and it's because we think that our money is our money. And it's not. It's not our money. I remember this past summer when we were in Grand Haven, we were sitting on the little dock where the big boats kind of come in and out. And this big boat came in, and on the back of the boat, you know how they name boats? It said, mine, mine, mine. I mean, this was like just this unbelievable yacht. It was ridiculous. And Kayla and I looked at that, and we just both kind of laughed, and she goes, we should go spray paint that tonight and say, banks, 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 right? That's whose it is, isn't it, right? It's the banks. The banks own it, right? And I'm not talking about Beth Bank. You could have that, I guess, maybe. But here's the deal. If the bank doesn't own it and you really do own it, is it really yours? Because at that point, it should say, God's, God's, God's. But how we see things really, really matters. Do we see it as God's property? Or do we see it as, man, I have worked hard. I have put this sweat equity into this. It's mine. It's all about me. This is my stuff. And I would argue that's not the case at all. Flip with me to Matthew 6. And if you don't have your Bibles, again, we'll put this one up on the screen. And we're going to kind of wrap up with this verse and talk about a few things here. Here's what it says. Do not store up for yourself treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasure in heaven where moths and rust do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. Then listen to this line. For where your treasure is, treasure, think holistically too, everything. Your time, your talent, your treasure, your life. Where the center of your being is, okay, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. If you want to really see someone's priorities, and I know we all like swallow hard when we hear this. You want to see someone's priorities, look at their bank statement. It will literally show you their number one, number two, number three, number four priority in their life, just laid out. And where does God fall on that? And do we see our treasures as God's treasures? Okay, because oftentimes our treasure is not in the right place, which means our heart, our core, our total person is not in the right place. Let me give you some stats real quick. This is kind of crazy. This is from 2015, and this is just from the United States. So I want to talk about our culture for a minute, and let me tell you something. There is zero difference between our culture and our church, just so you guys know, which is sad. Should look really different. It's not. So these stats are all of us together. Let me just throw this first statement up here. People, on average, are spending $1.26 for every dollar they make. We're living beyond our means. Why? Because we're entitled. Because it's our money, right? We think we work hard, we earn it, we'll spend it. And we'll not only spend it, we'll spend above and beyond what we made because we need that. We work hard. So we should have a yacht that says mine, mine, mine on it so I can decompress after a hard day's work. Right? So let me show you another crazy stat for a minute. Well, this whole side of the auditorium, you guys all stand up for a minute. And then let's go like Jake Isley's row forward. You first three rows. Sal, I didn't call you. Sit down, please. Thank you. You first three rows, stand up for a minute. Okay, a rough estimate here. This is about 70% of you all. Okay, 70% of us live paycheck to paycheck, no matter what our income level is. No matter. It doesn't matter if we make $20,000 or $200,000. We live paycheck to paycheck, which means one thing goes wrong, we're in crisis. 70% of us. Okay? You guys can sit down. Look at this. This will help you, well, it will convict you for a minute, and then a few of you will be like, oh, I didn't stand, so that's me. So 16% of you, which if there's 200 of us here, would be about 32 of us, we're in bankruptcy. Okay, so 16% of our culture in 2015 was in bankruptcy. 2% was beyond bankruptcy. I don't even know what this means. That's like bad. That's bad news bears, okay? 2% of you are millionaires. Now Sal's like, I'm going to stand up, right? You want? Okay. 2% are millionaires, and 10% are on their way to be millionaires. So that's kind of encouraging. But the majority of us, friends, we live paycheck to paycheck, no matter what the circumstance, no matter how much we make. And that's a scary place to live because it all depends on us. And that's when we really start to believe that our money is ours. It's ours. It's ours. And we're going to spend it. And the truth is, we spend way outside what we need to spend. Okay? Let me show you how this kind of trickles into the church specifically. These are 2015 statistics again. 12% of believers, okay, tithe. They give more, they give 10% or more than their annual income. Okay, 12% of giving believers tithe. They actually give 10%. Now, I noted on here Luke 11:42. Part of that is because that's today's reading. Those of you guys that are tracking with us in our 10 for 40, you're reading the end of Luke chapter 11. And you're going to read that. And in this, this is the woes to the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. And Jesus says, woe to you who give a tenth of your dill and cumin and your spices and your herbs, right? But you neglect mercy and you neglect justice. And he goes on, he says, you should, let me read exactly how he states this. You should have practiced the latter without leaving the former. So he says, you should practice the latter, the grace, the mercy, the authenticity that he's called you into without neglecting the former, which Jesus is still referencing this giving, this tithe. Now, do I believe biblically, New Testament, under Jesus' reign and authority, that we're called to give 10%? Nope. Some of you are like, yes. You may be called to give more. You may be called to give a lot more. 10% to me is a good biblical starting point. And you look at that and you look at your annual income and you go, can I give 10%? And if I can, you give it. And that's a good starting point. And if you can't, if you're going to be broke and living on the streets, I don't think that's what Jesus is calling you to do. But some of us can give 15, 20, 30, 40%, and we can still live a life that is very, very comfortable. And so what Jesus makes it all about, every time he talks about giving, he makes it about his heart. It's about the heart. It's the heart of the Father. It's about your heart. How do you connect? What is your heart telling you you're called to give? So all believers that give on, if we average them all together, okay, give a total of 3% of their annual income. This is what the church in the United States, the wealthiest country in the world, or very close, we give 3% of our annual income. That's what we give to God's work. And that 40 plus years, what's that mean? That means that stat has not changed for 40 plus years. It's been the exact same. It's always been this 3%, okay? So we have to learn. We have to change our mindset. We have to understand what a gift is. We have to understand what we do with gifts, okay? So here's what I wanted you to do. I want you to all pull out that envelope that you got. Did everyone get one? Everyone got one in their hand? Anyone need an envelope? If you do, slip your hand up real quick. Sal, seriously, you're the first guy here. Okay. Sal's got six of them in his pocket. He knows what's coming here. Take a minute and open it. You're welcome. This is your gift. You did not earn it. You did not control it. You simply showed up. It was given to you by the grace that the Holy Spirit wanted by the order of you came in. How many of you got $1? How many of you got $2? How many of you got $3? How many of you got the $1,000 bill? No, just kidding. That's not in there. So here's what we're going to do. Listen carefully to this. This will be one of the most exhilarating things that you've ever done. I promise you this, okay? It's a gift, right? It's a gift. So we're gonna play a little game here. And here are the three rules of this game. You can give as much as you want of the money that's in your hand. to someone else. You cannot refuse a gift. There's some of you in here that are like, I'm going to give my money away and I'm not going to take another gift. Find those people and give them money, because I love it when people try to refuse a gift. You cannot refuse a gift, and you cannot give your gift back immediately. Okay? So if JP comes and gives me $3, I can't just give it back to him. I have to go disperse it somewhere else, and then if I have $3 down the road, I can go back to JP and give him $3. Okay? So you can give as much as you want. You cannot refuse a gift, and you cannot give the gift back immediately. All right? This is going to be fun. You have 3 minutes. Stand up. Have fun. Go. Move. I'll give you a countdown warning. Say hi. Give some gifts, okay? Say hi. Give some gifts. Oh, geez. Now I'm in the game. Okay. Good morning. Thanks for playing. Keep going, keep going. Got 2 minutes. 2 minutes. Meet some people. Oh, Jacob, thank you so much. I'm such a generous guy, Jacob. Here you go, Jake. Jake to Jake. Whoa, you just got a lot of money. Fine, you got a minute and a half. Find someone that doesn't have any money. Find someone that doesn't have any money and put it in their hands. It's so fun. Here you go. Oh, Chris, there you go. Thanks for being here. You got 60 seconds. 60 seconds. You better make your final transactions. Oh, man, some of you, you're deciding right now, should I hang on to it or should I give it? You got 30 seconds. Let the Spirit lead you. 30 seconds. Okay, 10. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Awesome. Okay. Was that fun? Yes, it was. Was that easy to give? Did it almost get contagious? Huh? Give it like it gets a little contagious, right? Would you do it again? Yes. Awesome. I agree. Now, here's the interesting part. There's someone in our faith community who has been struggling for a while. And so a lot of you know here, we work very hard, and for the last 3 years, we have exceeded our 50-50 of giving that we want to make sure that we give over half of what comes in and it goes out. And it's not worried about things at the church and staff and taking care of rent and taking care of insurance and all these things. We always want to make sure half or more is going out. So we have paid their rent for the last 2 months. And the very ironic part of this activity, and I really didn't even mean for it to work this way, is the amount of money that was placed in all of your hands to steward was within $5 of their rent for a month. And so I want to ask you one more question. I wonder if we could assure them that they have one more month covered, that they can go one more month and they know that their rent is covered. So right up here are two glass vases. And if you'd like to help cover that rent, I just invite you to come forward if you want to do that. Saw a 20 in there. I see a couple fives, another five. I'm willing to bet that there's way more than the 425 we started with. I'm willing to bet that. So you just ensured that someone else has another month of where they're living. That their power's on, that their water's on, that their rent is paid, that they have that dignity. Let me ask you something. And I'm going to say it loud. I'm going to use both mics. Was it fun?
Yes.
Was it easy?
Yes.
Would you do it again?
Yes.
Why? Why? Because it was not your money. I've always wanted to do that. It seemed like the right time. We're going to take up a second offering for the mic I just broke. It's not your money. It's not my money. It's his money. It's his time. It's not our life, it's his life that he gave us. It's not our talent, it's his talent that he blessed you with. But we have to understand that. We have to change the way we view things. We have to see things as a gift. We have to understand they're not ours. And then it becomes easy, and it becomes fun, and it becomes contagious. And we're willing to do it again and again and again. Let me end with this. Look at this last quote here. We are not owners of our money. We are managers of it. We're managers of it. And there's a lot of beauty behind being a manager. Because a manager means you don't have to worry about all the crap that the owner has to deal with. Jesus is the owner, and he'll deal with all the crap, and he'll deal with it in the right way. You and I, friends, we're simply managers of it. That's what God has called us to be. Of our life, of our time, of our talents, and of our treasures. That's what God wants us to understand. You didn't create it. You don't own it. You can't control it. It's his, and it's a gift to you and to I. Will you stand with me? And let's close in prayer. I'm going to say one more thing, and I probably shouldn't. But this hit me really hard at about midnight last night. In Scripture, in 2 Timothy 3:16, Paul's writing to Timothy, and he says, all Scripture is God-breathed, and it's useful for teaching. And then he says it's also useful for correcting, training, and rebuking. Correcting, training, and rebuking. We throw that Matthew 6 slide back up there real quick, Jeffrey. When we look at that Matthew 6, and friends, this is why we call these our treasure boxes. It's why we don't pass a plate. I've been at church staff at a few different places, and the thing that drove me nuts was like, when do we take the offering? It was always this question. When do we work that in? How do we do a separate song? How do we have someone come up and share something while we pass these plates? Why do we pass the plates? Put a box in the back, and it's between you and Jesus. It's between you two. It's your heart. So that's why we call it the treasure box, because where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Now, what does this have to do with 2 Timothy 3:16? Because here's what hit me really hard last night. And I was thinking about my life, and I'm kind of this middle-aged man, right? I'm 38 years old. And so we have this idea of training, correcting, and rebuking. Okay? Training, correcting, and rebuking. For those of you in your 20s, your late teens, your 20s, this is a teaching for all of us. But those of you youngsters, this is a training exercise for you. God is training you. He's trying to speak into you. Use your treasures right. It's not yours. It's a gift from me. For those of us in our 30s, 40s, right, scrambling to figure life out, I would suggest this is a correcting. Because a lot of us are in these seasons of life where we're trying to figure, man, we got to redo our budget. We got to figure out how we do this. We got more kids than we ever planned on. Or, you know, I lost my job and things are getting really serious. And so this is a correcting for us in that season. And here's the hard thing. For those of you seasoned folks, and I say this with all due respect, I believe this is a rebuking. And I believe it's a rebuking because as we approach the end of our life here, if all we're worried about is consuming earthly treasures where moth and rust destroy, then we've missed something. Okay? So for our young generation, may this train you, may it guide you of how important this is. For us middle generation hanging on by threads, trying to, may it be a correcting, a re-guiding, a steering to what we're supposed to be doing. And for those of us who have done a lot of life, and we're kind of on that tail end, it might be a rebuking of where we're really putting our priorities, of where Jesus really falls in line with our hearts. Let me pray. God, I ask, God, that that these words not be mine. God, I pray that they come from you. God, that you did what you needed to do in me this week in your word. God, I thank you for where your Holy Spirit has convicted and taken me and my family in how we see our time, our talent, and our treasures. God, may we be a faith community that understands the gift of life, that understands that we didn't create it. We can't control it. It's a gift. God, may we be a community that lives well, that uses our time well. God, forgive us for our sin of omission. All those times that we've missed. because we've been lazy or indifferent or idle. God, may we understand that you give us the talents that you want us to have. You don't desire us to be the person sitting next to us or in front of us or behind us. You desire us to be us. And you've gifted us exactly how you wanted. You've knit us together. May we see the gift in that. And then, God, for our finances, for our stuff, for our boats, for our houses, for our cars, for our stuff, God, may we see them as yours, yours, yours. We love you. We thank you. And all God's people said, amen. 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 Bless God. Have a great week. Please.